Throughout human history, family has played a major role in almost everyone's life. Maybe Robinson Crusoe had thoughts of family. When God created the world, he looked around and he saw that everything was good, except for one thing. What was not good? That Adam was alone. And so he created Eve. And so the first family was born. And therefore God blessed the family. It was the building block of communities. And the community, of course, is the building block of nations. But quickly enough, in Genesis 3, the scriptures teach us that families are easily fractured. Almost as fast as it was created, the family came under attack. God's plan, of course, in calling Abraham was to recreate what Adam had marred, including God's family, starting with Israel, but not stopping at Israel. So all over the world, families are still a very big deal. And for most of us, we have experienced that. Family relationships, what we call our background family, family of origin, have massive weight and influence on our everyday lives. And back in the time of Jesus, the Jewish family had an extra added significance. A Jewish family was the local expression of the larger Jewish nation, the people of God, or Israel, the children of God. You were who you were because of God's people, because your family is a mini family of the nation of Israel. So one of the ongoing defining Jewish identities throughout history has been the meal called Passover. Once the lamb has been slain at the temple, the family would gather and eat together in remembrance of their exodus from slavery back down in Egypt. It was very much a family celebration. And so as a Jewish family member, you were never supposed to disrespect your family. It was a cardinal rule that you never abandoned or disrespected them. That's why the parable of the prodigal son is so shocking. The prodigal disrespects his father immensely by asking for his inheritance early. It's as if he wants his dad to be dead. And then the father, what a scene, sees his son in the distance coming back, hitches up his robe and runs to him, which is not an old man thing to do, is it? But there's interesting family dynamics in the Bible. But through Jesus' life and ministry, not only does he radically define the Passover around himself, helping us to look forward to even greater rescue than the people had out of Egypt, but he also redefines what he calls family. And it's rather surprising and unsettling in some way. And there are five scenes in this little passage, and I think there's a question for each scene, which will help us understand. So the first question is Jesus crazy? Of course the answer is no, but that's what his family were thinking. Our passage starts in verse 20, and we read, Jesus entered a house, and the crowds began to gather around so that he and his disciples couldn't even get time to eat. When his family heard what was happening, they tried to take him away. He's crazy, they said. He's out of his mind. Jesus' reputation by that stage as an extraordinary healer, an exorcist, and a teacher with great authority has led big crowds to come and follow him. Now, I suspect that this time the crowds were there out of curiosity. What's he going to do next? Is he going to... And they were sort of milling around. What's he going to say? What exciting parable is he going to tell us today? And so there was all sorts of excitement and hectic goings-on happening. And it appears that Jesus and his disciples had become so busy that they often forgot to even eat or rest. Who's had such a busy day that they've never even had a chance to rest? I'm sure that in your life you've had one or two of those sort of days. Jesus, it appears, once his public ministry started and he was in villages, that happened to him every day. So it seems that Jesus' family have heard about this. So his mother and his brothers become deeply concerned about his physical and mental health. His life has taken such a radical and surprising change. Now he's constantly being mobbed by crowds wanting his attention. So much so that he wasn't looking after himself. He's gone mad, which is quite logical for the people to say. So Jesus' family want to rescue him. They want to take him away back home to Nazareth. Let's go back to the normal life as the family, they say. They will appear again soon. So the first question is Jesus crazy? And so we'll leave that hanging. Second question, is he possessed? Jesus' public ministry has not only drawn the attention of his family, the Jewish bigwigs from down in Jerusalem have sent a delegation because they've heard some very disturbing news about Jesus. What was he doing? What was he saying? It didn't fit with their narrow criteria, nor did he have their approval. These leaders had apparently been sent by the Sanhedrin, the Jewish governing council in Jerusalem, to check Jesus out. And because of what they've heard, they were there to undermine his influence with the crowds. So, he's possessed by Beelzebub. He's a Satanist, they cried. He's driving out demons by the prince of demons. Now, have you ever been in a schoolyard when a bully wants to control another kid? What do? They make up nasty names, and they call those names directly at the person. Whip, loser, fatso. That was a common one when I was a kid, if somebody was a little overweight. Retard, ugly face, crybaby. And these days they use swear words, or even worse. It's a way for a bully to control a situation and get everybody's attention. Have you ever experienced that type of bullying yourself? If you see it happen, it's very, very demeaning to the person being bullied, particularly if it works. And so these scribes attempt to attack Jesus using this method. He's possessed by Beelzebub, they cry. Now, they don't deny his exorcisms or his healings. They don't deny that he's got a powerful message. And so to attack him, they just simply say that the power comes from Satan. Stick a very heavy label like this on Jesus, and then it won't matter what he says or does. They want the crowds to back off, they want Jesus to be silenced, and they don't want the crowd anywhere involved. They want them to come and listen to the scribes. But that's so sad. It's so sad because one of the most prominent miracles that Jesus performed was driving out evil spirits. These scribes should have celebrated Jesus' ministry. Tormented people were freed and being healed. Satan's dominion was shrinking. But these bully boy scribes didn't care. They condemned Jesus as Beelzebub because they had some sort of conspiracy theory out against him. And they used it to ridicule him and try to sideline him. But did it work? What was Jesus' response? Well, that's what question 3 is in verses 23 to 27. And the question is Jesus the stronger man? And so Jesus responds to these scribes. He says, how can Satan stand against Satan? How can Satan cast out Satan? A kingdom divided by civil war will collapse. Similarly, a family splintered by feuding will fall apart. And if Satan is divided and fights against himself, how can he stand? He will never survive. Jesus uses common sense. How do you rebut bullies? Well, you stand up to them. And that's what Jesus does. And he gives a very logical argument. Their accusation against him doesn't make sense. Even the most sensible person would know that. Why would Satan want Jesus to cast out demons from people who were already possessed? That would divide and weaken his power. Satan wouldn't survive such a stupid action. And so there's no way. So Jesus illustrates further and he says, Who is powerful enough to enter into the house of a strong man and plunder his household? Well, only someone even stronger. Someone who could tie him up and then plunder his house. Now, who, of course, is the stronger one? Jesus. And who's the strong man? Satan. So instead of working for Satan, the strong man, Jesus is breaking down his household, person by person. He is plundering Satan's goods, and Satan is powerless to stop him. Jesus has tied him up, it says here, and is freeing his captives. Isn't that good news? Even today, Jesus has the power to have that sort of ministry and effect in our lives. The kingdom of Satan is shrinking away to the glorious kingdom of God. And that's worth celebrating. Is Jesus crazy? Mm-hmm. Is he possessed? Mm-hmm. Is he the stronger man? Mm-hmm. Two no's and a yes. Our fourth question is Jesus forgiving? There is a serious matter here. These scribes have come from Jerusalem and they are accusing Jesus of being demonic. They were doing what was unforgivable. Once a label like that is in place, how can the people respond? See, once you label what is in fact the work of the Holy Spirit as the work of the devil, there's really no way back. Jesus is possessed by the Holy Spirit, not by Satan. To go on saying that he is Beelzebub is really unforgivable. These scribes were inverting the truth, calling light darkness and darkness light. They were so convinced by their own foolish conspiracy theories against Jesus that they'd lost touch with reality. They'd become blind and nothing was going to change their minds. Jesus could have done anything and it wouldn't have changed their minds. What is the unforgivable sin? Well, please don't ever imagine that you were going to commit it. Verse 28 actually says that all human sins can be forgiven. We pray the Lord's Prayer because we believe that, don't we? Forgive us our sins. The one exception here is when all through our lives, as these scribes were doing, we might accuse Jesus of being in leagues with the devil or in cahoots with him and therefore doing evil. Rather than being the Spirit-led Saviour, we would call him the Spirit-led demon. That is unforgivable if you end your life in that position. And while we all sin in thought, in word and in deed, it's not anything like that, what the scribes were doing. So be assured that God is on your side. He can't love you more than he loves you right at this moment. And is keen, if you open your heart to him, to forgive any sin. Is Jesus forgiving? Of course he is. Question 5. Who is Jesus' true family? Family, like wives, you can't live with them and you can't live without them. Isn't that what the saying says? You remember back to verse 21. Jesus' family has come to find Jesus and to take him back to Nazareth. They think he's mentally ill. When they arrive, verse 31 says, Jesus' mother and brothers came to see him. They stood outside and sent word for him to come out and talk with them. Maybe they wanted to convince him to come back to Nazareth. There was a crowd sitting around Jesus and someone said, your mother and your brothers are outside asking for you. Now, from elsewhere in the Gospels, we know that Jesus had at least four brothers, and they're all named. James, Judas, Simon, I think, and Joseph were his four brothers. But he also had a couple of sisters. And so, we know of Mary. Anyway, the family has arrived to try and talk sense into Jesus. All this commotion about exorcisms, healings, all this run-in with the religious authorities, the scribes and the Pharisees, or let alone his inability to look after himself, has convinced them that they need to fetch him and take him back to Nazareth. Now, I want you to feel their confusion. Sit in Mary's place. Now, she knows that Jesus is special. But what she's heard that's going on has concerned her deeply, and she's gathered the family and said, we need to get him back to Nazareth. Now, I'm not sure exactly what was going on in her mind, but what Jesus was doing certainly didn't fit with her picture of what he should be doing. Have you ever felt that about a family member? That they're not quite doing what you would hope they might do? I think if we've got children, that happens to us all. As a mother, many of you are sitting there as mother. Can you feel Mary's confusion? And in that picture, she's the one standing outside looking in. And I think that's saying something about what's going on. But of course, Jesus has other plans. He has a big vocation. He has a public ministry to fulfill. I have no doubt at all that Jesus loved his family deeply. I think that we saw a few weeks back that even on the cross, when he was in agony, he looked down and he saw Mary and he said, dear Mum, John will look after you. Deeply loved his mum, and I'm sure that it says that he made a special appearance to his brothers, at least to James. And they were there in the upper room in Acts chapter 1, Jesus and his brothers. Lovely thought. But here, at this time, they want to take him back. But Jesus won't be a part of that. And he has other plans. And so in verse 33, Jesus replies to the crowd that are gathered, who is my mother? Who are my brothers? Then he looked at those around him and said, look, these are my brothers, my mother. Anyone who does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. Now sit with that for a moment. What is Jesus really saying? What is he actually trying to convince the people gathered that's happening? You see, this really, if you think Jewish family, this was unthinkable. This was scandalous. He cuts through the Jewish tradition of the view of family in one clean slice. He will do that with Sabbath observation, with dietary laws, and also with the Passover. He has a different vocation, a different calling and mission, and it involves breaking some of the hollow traditions, even the one about family, and also those other things I mentioned. And so we ask the question, what is God up to? What is God really wanting us to learn from this passage? Well, I believe that God is doing something very extraordinary through the life and ministry of Jesus, and we are here today as the family of God, gathered because of passages like this. God is creating a new family, the family of Abraham that doesn't have just Israel at the center. It has the whole of the people of God. And I think that that really says a bit about what our true family is. It's not the biological family, it is the family of God. And so we read verse 33 as a deeply scandalous point. If we read it that way, it's true. But if we read it that way, we've understood what the ministry of Jesus was about. The Apostle John understood this. And so in the beginning of his gospel, he makes the same point in John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. To all who did receive him, that's Jesus, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become what? Children of God. Not a lovely thought? Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor of a husband's will, but born of God. And so we as a church have been born of God. We don't have to have been born a physical descendant of Abraham. We don't have to be a Jewish family to be a part of God's people. And that's how Mark has set up this scene. Here are his physical old family standing outside. And here are his new family who are inside with him. Those inside are keen to follow Jesus and to obey God's word, while those outside, his old family and the scribes and others, are missing the point. And they want to stay with the old ways. But Jesus is into the new wineskins, where he wants the new wine to be. Let me quote Tom Wright. The gospel, an allegiance to Jesus, can produce a division, often an unexpected and unwelcome one, in every group or society where they make their way. Mark's call to his readers then and now is to stick with Jesus whatever the cost. Like that last sentence. Mark's call to his readers then and now is to stick with Jesus whatever the cost. Jesus and his people are our true family. That, of course, doesn't mean at all that we don't live in the age where our other family matters. Of course it matters. But here's the key point of this passage. Following Jesus is the first priority of every believer, ahead of the family of origin, because we are part of God's new family. That's us, the church. We are Jesus' family. And that tie is more important than our human family tie. We belong to God's family and we are brothers and sisters in Christ. Isn't that good news? As we journey together, we need to do it together. We need to do it united and focused together. We need to undergird that with prayer and fellowship with each other. So please come on Tuesday and next Sunday. So church is not a building that you go to. It's a family to belong to. Isn't that a good idea? Like that picture says. Church is not a building you go to. It's a family to belong to. And as verse 35 says, anyone who does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. And I'm sure that's you. Am I right? I'm sure that's you. God bless you this week. We need to be people of meekness and majesty, which is what we're going to sing. So a moment of quietness as we prepare to sing.